few years ago, I attended a panel discussion where a group of athletes discussed their experiences with concussion. When they opened up to the audience for questions, there were a number of people who addressed the microphone, but there was one man in particular who I'll always remember. He first thanked the panel and congratulated those who had returned to sport. He explained that he was not an athlete, but he was struggling to return to work after his concussion. He wanted to know what resources or research was being done to help the everyday person living with concussion, because he felt that there seemed to be a lot more resources to support athletes. I think that his question really stuck with me because he represents the type of person that I want to help. I started my career as a physiotherapist working in brain injury rehab at Parkwood Institute in London, Ontario, helping people injured in car accidents, workplace injuries, assaults, or falls at home. And now, as a scientist at Western University and Lawson Health Research Institute, I collaborate with clinicians and clients on clinical-based research that's driven by questions from our clients and clinicians. Our team is called Research to Practice. So we know that the majority of brain injuries are not sport-related. So what about that person injured in the car accident, the woman abused by her partner, or the child who fell from the monkey bars? What do we really know about how to help these individuals with concussion? And the truth is that much of what we've learned in the sport concussion literature can be applied to the everyday person living with concussion. In 2017, a group of researchers from around the globe collated the best available evidence in sport concussion. Their work is known as the Berlin Statement and is published in the British Journal of Sports Medicine. Clinicians and clients can access this document for free to clarify any questions they may have concerning diagnosis or acute management. For example, the majority of sport-related concussions do not involve a loss of consciousness, and they may also not be related to a direct hit to the head. The Berlin group concluded that a concussion may be caused by either a direct blow to the head, face, or neck, or by a hit to anywhere else in the body that causes an impulsive force up to the head. It's also well documented in the sport literature that symptom onset may be delayed. And from the neuroimaging literature, we've learned that a concussion may not show up on standard X-ray or CT. Now, this does not make diagnosis any easier, but it's imperative that this type of information is disseminated and understood by not only our clients and clinicians, but also by our insurance providers to ensure that people are not restricted from the services that they need. When it comes to acute management, we used to believe that you had to rest until all of your symptoms went away. Now the recommendation is to rest for the first 1 to 2 days and then gradually resume normal activities using symptoms as your guide. This strategy is outlined in both the Berlin Statement and the Ontario Neurotrauma Foundation guidelines for concussion. But it's still really tricky for our clients and clinicians to operationalize. This is why an occupational therapist at Parkwood, who recognized this in her clients, created a pacing points program, where she would assign a point value to activities based on how difficult and symptom-provoking it was for that client. Then each of her clients would be assigned a point per day maximum, much like diet programs assign points for food. And through the collaborative efforts of our clients, clinicians, researchers, app developers, and funding through community partners and the Hospital Foundation, her idea has finally become an app. And once launched, users will be able to track their own activity and their own symptoms. And through the collection of user data, the researchers will be able to evaluate this strategy and also be able to figure out how to further tailor this gradual return to activity strategy for the guidelines. Working alongside each other, clients, clinicians, and researchers is what our team calls a collaborative, practice-based approach to research and innovation. Another example from our clinical site is using a standardized assessment battery for our group interventions. our Parkwood occupational and physical therapists created a customizable circuit training group to address the common complaints of our clients with concussion. And they also did it to help support the wait list. But the point is, every client that goes through that intervention completes the same assessment before and after that 16-week intervention. This supports our quality improvement initiatives, but it also means that as researchers, we now have a large enough data set that we can look at not only how effective this intervention is, but to be able to identify client characteristics to figure out who this intervention might work for the best. So I encourage anyone listening to think about how a practice-based approach might be modeled at your site. Because those of us on our team at Research to Practice have tried to model this in each of our initiatives. And much like the guy at the microphone a few years ago, we all believe that there needs to be more resources to support the everyday person living with concussion, and believe that together we can make that happen. Thank you.